Alright guys, I got another episode of GTA Stories for you. This time around, it's something a little bit different, but if you enjoy it, don't forget to like and subscribe, because we got a whole lot more on the way, and I'm working on a really big episode of GTA Stories right now, so I hope you guys enjoy this one in the meantime. Toronto's rap scene has pretty much become mainstream today. The city's artists have not only displayed a lesser-known side of Canadian culture to the world, but have also featured what it's like growing up in some of the roughest neighborhoods the country has to offer. And then you have Drake, and as much as people like to make fun of him, he's definitely put the city on the map by dominating the hip-hop charts for almost a decade now. And believe me, that was pretty painful to say, but I gotta give credit where it's due. With that being said, Drake wouldn't even have a platform if it wasn't for all the people I'm going to talk about today. Most of them being forgotten pioneers who laid out a blueprint for other Toronto artists to succeed. And if I want to properly tell you guys their story, I gotta go all the way back to 1979. The year your dad probably wishes it was again, so he could get away with saying stupid shit. The single Rapper's Delight by the Sugar Hill Gang would be the first hip-hop record ever to hit the shelves. And a few months later, James McGee, who was originally from North Carolina but moved to Toronto back in 1974, was hired to record a hip-hop single called Lady's Delight, which in no way is a Canadian knockoff of Rapper's Delight. James McGee was hired by George Lewis, who owned Monica's production company, which later became Scorpio Records. Lewis had hopes on capitalizing on the success of the New York single, and James McGee, who had already been a sole performer within Toronto's downtown district, was the perfect candidate to make George Lewis's dreams come true. Which unfortunately they didn't, because the single didn't actually do really that good. James McGee would go by the name Mr. Q on this record, and he actually produced a couple of other singles with the label. You had bangers like DJ Style, Rapping Time, Party Party, and Party Rap, which you can clearly tell they took a lot of time to come up with these names. But all jokes aside, some of these singles were actually pretty decent. I don't think you and your friends are going to be cruising around and be like, let's slap in Party Party anytime soon, but they definitely hold some historical value. The single Party Rap included multiple lyrics about the 1979 Mississauga train derailment. Hip-hop historians, or rather hip-hop rhinoceroses, as they should be referred to as, attribute Party Rap to being the first narrative-based hip-hop song. DJ Style was also featured in the 2006 old school compilation The Big Apple Rappin', which also featured the single Rapper's Delight. But back in the day when Mr. Q was popping out these singles quicker than you could think thoughts, he was largely forgotten and completely ignored by the Canadian media. Instead, recognition was given to the Bum Rap as the first Canadian hip-hop single, which was performed by an Ottawa-based comedy duo known as the Singing Fools, which kinda shows you how people viewed hip-hop in Canada at the time, seeing it more as a joke and not to be taken seriously. In the United States, you had singles like The Message coming out, which elevated the hip-hop genre and really took it to another level. But here in Canada, we pretty much didn't even really understand what the genre was supposed to be, considering the Singing Fools was our best rap group at the time. This wouldn't last for long though, because another extremely important influence on Toronto's hip-hop scene was a guy named Ron Nielsen and his radio show called The Fantastic Voyage. This radio show aired on Saturdays on CKLM between 1983 and 1991. This exposed Toronto teens to hip-hop music, with them creating an underground scene. Ron Nelson also organized concerts, bringing acts like Run-DMC, Public Enemy, and Boogie Down Productions to Toronto. It was at these rap concerts throughout the 1980s that the first Toronto MCs were able to hit the stage, which led to a female rapper known as Michie Mee being signed by an American label in 1988. She would be the first Canadian artist to do so, but unfortunately, her album flopped in the US. But her contribution would not go unnoticed by Toronto's rap scene. It only furthered to inspire other MCs like Maestro Fresh West, Rumble and Strong, the Get Loose Crew, Simply Majestic, and the Dream Warriors, who would all help form the industry within Canada throughout the 1990s. Let Your Backbone Slide by Maestro Fresh West would hit the Billboard charts in the United States, but it always seemed that Toronto's rap scene was one step behind. By this year, you had NWA drop albums like Straight Out of Compton, which completely shifted the landscape of hip-hop, where you had majority of artists now finding success within reality rap, otherwise known as gangster rap, and this left Canadian artists struggling to adapt to the changing music scene. In 1990, Toronto didn't even have a hip-hop station, which left majority of fans relying off American ones. It also left Toronto artists with no platform to grow. By 1993, the scene was hurting so bad, much music was only playing one rap song, Check the OR, by another Ottawa-based comedy group, Organized Rhyme, which also featured a young Tom Green before his rise to fame. Just imagine Tom Green being the most popping rapper in the country. That's a sad time. But within Toronto, rap had become extremely popular with the younger generation. Groups like Ghetto Concept and TBTBT, which is a lot harder to say than you think, both released albums in 1994, which were well received by audiences, and it earned both groups Juno Awards in 1995. Ghetto Concept wasn't a culmination of two rappers who came from rival neighborhoods. They had a unique sound that was almost gritty but upbeat at the same time, and many Toronto artists today view them as a huge stepping stone into the city gaining its own identity within hip-hop. And then TBTBT is just, it's not my style, that's for sure. But by 1996, the Canadian perception of hip-hop had changed. You could now listen to Canadian rappers across multiple stations all over the country. This also encouraged more Canadian labels to invest in the genre, and the industry within the country would only continue to grow, because within the same year, Cardinal Official and Chaclair released Rap Essentials Volume 1. With all this happening, another Vancouver-based rap group, known as the Rascals, would start to garner an American audience, and they had teamed up with Cardinal Official and Chaclair to make the song Northern Touch. It was originally recorded as a feature on a new Rascals album that fell through in 1998. The rap group then decided to release it as a single in 1999 to critical acclaim. It reached top 10 in most major markets. It propelled the careers of each artist who performed the single, especially in the case of Cardinal Official, who had a successful career within the US, along with having multiple hits with artists like Akon and Jeezy, and basically was Canada's mainstream representative in the hip-hop world before Drake. And he's from Regent Park, which is pretty cool, but to be honest, like 90% of the rappers I've talked about today are from there, so there's probably just something in their water. But I'll be covering in the next episode what they're putting in the city water to make Toronto rappers. No, I'm just messing around. But I will be covering Toronto's rising underground rappers, which were more inspired by gangster rap in the mid-2000s, and how the city's rap scene really took off in the 2010s. But with that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. I hope I did these guys justice. Like I was saying, they're true pioneers within Canada's hip-hop scene. And if I left anyone out, definitely don't be shy to leave it down in the comments below. And with that being said, I guess that's where I'll catch you guys. Have a good one.